All right, welcome to part two of our Satsang-A-Thon on Memorial Day. We ended the last one by an interruption, but you know what? That's very good to realize that you absolutely do get interrupted on your focus. That's how it works here. You have to bounce back. It's not like the world steps aside and says, "Oh, okay. Oh, we are allowing you to do unlimited satsang." Now the world doesn't even recognize satsang at all. The ego doesn't even recognize it. The ego sees no use for it, no purpose for it. In fact, the ego is suspicious of it, because of course you're trying to move towards remembrance of what you are, and the ego is trying to block remembrance of what you are. Okay, cross purposes. The ego and the Holy Spirit are at cross purposes. It will always be at cross purposes. There's no way to integrate the two. It's not the purpose. The Holy Spirit's purpose is not to integrate with the ego. It's to wean us away from the ego. The ego's purpose is forgetfulness of what we are. The Holy Spirit's purpose is remembrance of what we are. It will always be that way. So, the ego does not set up the world for satsang. The Holy Spirit does. But the ego will interfere here. You'll get constant interferences, always there are interferences. Yeah, you have to grab the time at all times, seize the moment. And then when the interference comes, roll with the punch and then get back to it. Get back to satsang and seize the next moment. That is literally what one has to do. I mean, most of us don't live in a cloistered situation. Maybe we feel that some kind of restriction on our freedom, but it's actually very helpful for us. And we don't spend times in retreats all the time. Now, I said that formal satsang can be very helpful because it's designed so there's no interruptions. But even within those contexts, there are interruptions where people will act up certain ways and there's no excuses. You can do it wherever you are. You have to do the best you can. So I'm doing the best I can right here, right now. But certainly, I have to roll with the punches. Things happen around me. I don't have a situation where I'm cloistered and I have a shut door and nobody can bother me, because I do this outside. And their neighbors coming and going, solicitors, mail, the mail's being delivered, dogs are barking, all sorts of stuff happens. Just like it happens in anyone's life, there's all sorts of activity going on at all times in this world. And none of that activity is satsang. Nobody is saying, "I need to take, 3 hours right now to focus in." So a few people are here and there, but it's invisible. There may be a lot of spiritual endeavor, clarification going on the planet, possible, but it's invisible, largely invisible. People have to sneak around like thieves to get the time. Because if you announce to the world, "Here is satsang," the ego is going to try and bust that up. Because the ego feels threatened by it. Again, the ego's purpose is forgetfulness of what we are. And to perfect that forgetfulness to the point where literally we feel no more attraction to what we really are. That's its purpose. The Holy Spirit's purpose is to speak truth to us and tell us that the ego's goal is impossible. Holy Spirit doesn't attack the ego's goal. It simply reminds us that it's impossible. There's just a big difference between attacking and reminding that it's impossible. Truth is not threatened. Holy Spirit merely tells us that truth is not threatened. It's not bothered. If it's not threatened, why should it be angry? Why should it feel threatened? Why should it be defensive? It's not. Holy Spirit just gives us a gentle reminder. Truth is not threatened. You still are exactly what you were created to be. Reality is still immaculate. It's never been attacked, never been harmed, never been threatened. And the ego's goal is impossible to reach, is futile. It's not an attack, that's just a reminder of truth. The ego thinks it's an attack, because the ego thinks that its goal is reachable, believes that, and that the Holy Spirit is trying to prevent the ego from reaching its goal. Not true. That's a lie. But the ego will always twist it to look that way. That simply is not true at all. It's another lie. Holy Spirit knows that the ego can't reach its goal. So, of course, the ego not being able to reach its goal is always trying to blame something. Always. What else? What else can the ego do? The ego cannot admit that its goal is impossible to reach. So it has to ascribe the futility to something other than impossibility. And then we get in, down the rabbit hole, because none of the blame is accurate. None of it's true. It's all a lie. Holy Spirit will get blamed. God will get blamed. Reality gets blamed. Everything gets blamed. We'll get blamed. Anything but the ego. Ego spreads blame around wherever it can. Sow the seeds of blame and guilt. It will do so, saying that somehow something is blocking the success of the ego's agenda, which is to give us the experience of being prime creator. Nothing's blocking it. If something's impossible, there's nothing that's blocking it. So there's no guilt. There's no guilt. No one or nothing is blocking us from experiencing being prime creator, because we cannot experience it. You can't say reality is blocking it, because that is our identity. That is what we are. That's how we were created. That's not blocking it. Blocking it means it's possible, but something is preventing it. That's not true. It's not possible from the very beginning. It's absurdity to place blocking on the level of reality and say that because reality is the way that it is, that it's somehow blocking reality from being something else. That's an absurdity. It's not a blocking. It simply is what it is. It's not trying to be something else. So that which is not trying to be something other than what it is cannot be said to be blocking being something other than what it is. It's an empty argument. This world right now is very much aligning, much of the world aligning with the egoic agenda. Most people have made their decisions. They decided which way we go. So many are aligning with the egoic agenda. The forewarning in the scriptures is that at the end times, you know, most of the world will have succumbed to Satan's kingdom, which is really the ego's agenda. Kingdom of the flesh, kingdom of darkness, all of that just means the egoic agenda, a forgetfulness of what we are. Almost everyone in the world will have succumbed to that. And even the quote-unquote, the elect will almost succumb. The elect meaning simply those who choose to remember what they are. Even they will be under enormous strain to forget, and to turn towards forgetfulness, which is we're at that point. We're already there. Compared to in the past, there's been enormous falling away. The superficial interest over the years has been swallowed up by the egoic agenda. People are kind of just turning to magic, basically. Talismans and magic and superficial trappings of spirituality, the gloss, you know, putting lipstick on a pig kind of thing, where the lack of will and push to keep clarifying is glossed over. And people will be, you know, somewhat dutiful, where they'll say, well, I'll read the book. Yeah, I got this book. I read that book. I saw that video. I attended this seminar. I kind of got the spiritualized stuff in the house, and And you know, just do the superficial things that make it look like there's a profound path taking place, profound inquiry, but it's not really taking place. That's what's happened. Because the demands of the ego are so severe now that literally you have to put a lot of time in now to offset the intensity and the ferocity of what the ego is doing, because the ego's insisting that everybody work nonstop on its agenda. And in order to avoid getting swallowed up by the ego's agenda, one has to put in a lot of time on self-inquiry, a lot. And not many of us are able to do that, are willing to do it, have been able to free up the time to do it, who grab the time. You know, we get home from work and there's a certain amount of time available, and you either use it for one purpose or the other. And whatever time you give to one purpose is taken from the other. That's just an inescapable fact of the situation here. You give 4 hours to television programs in the evening, you've taken 4 hours away from satsang. Just that simple. There's no way getting around that. You can't do it all. It's absurd to try and do it all, because let's say you give 4 hours to television shows and 4 hours of satsang, that's 8 hours a night. Let's say you get home at 5 o'clock, and that means you'll be up till 1 in the morning. Okay, well, you're going to be missing out on some sleep. But the fact is that the 4 hours you gave to the television programming, that could also have been given over to satsang. So you could have done 8 hours of it. So it's still taken away from it. And if one is willing to give 8 hours of focus, why not make it 8 hours on satsang instead of 4 and 4? Because the 4 and the 4 will end up kind of canceling each other out. Because, you know, it's like you take a couple steps in one direction, then you turn around and take a couple steps back in the opposite direction. And so how much progress is made? Certainly it's not optimal. So one cannot please both the ego, the ego's agenda, and the Holy Spirit's purpose. Can't please them both. Because each one, the ego will, whatever time we spend with clarification, the ego will be very displeased with that. Very displeased, because the ego will say, you know, we could have been using that time for the ego's agenda. So it's very displeased. And we'll say that it can't trust you, you know, can't trust you, and you're not dedicated enough. Whereas if you give a lot of time to the ego agenda, the Holy Spirit will remind you, you know, you're gonna miss the boat. Just, it's not attacking, but you're just reminding you of the facts of the situation that, you know, you don't want to miss the boat. And you will, if you get nowhere. You spend too much time with the ego's agenda, you won't get anywhere. You'll miss the boat. You certainly don't want to miss the boat, because the life in this world, life in the cave, is getting very yucky. You know, yuck. Really. It's really not a pleasant place or situation at all right now. It's never been a pleasant situation, to tell you the truth. But it's even less pleasant now. Because the pressure everyone is under, the attitudes of everyone hardening their position, and so many factors right now in the world, so many are making it less and less and less pleasant place, and it'll only go get much, much worse. But existence is always unpleasant. The ego does its very best to try and make it pleasant for us, but it's always unpleasant. The ego is, you know, desperate to get rid of this unpleasantness, because it feels that its purpose is being undermined by this. See, the ego might seem to be a friend because it's trying to guide us to get rid of the unpleasantness of this world, but its purpose is so that we forget what we are. We forget reality, forget our true home, forget our true functionality. And so we're being kept in this unimaginably terrible poverty, really. Existence is the very essence of poverty, of impoverishment. There's really nothing here. Everything is just crumbling, constantly crumbling. Just temporary. Everything's temporary. Just dust. It's temporary. Nothing permanent here. It's a horrible, horrible poverty. We're in the most grotesque ghetto imaginable here in this world. And the ego wants to keep us here. And it wants to make it more pleasant so that we stay here. So how is that a friend? When we say more pleasant, we simply mean pleasant enough so that we stay here. But we stay here not because it's pleasant. This world can never be made truly pleasant. It always will be incredibly distasteful for us. Because literally a picture is opposite of what we are. And we hate forgetting what we are. Can't stand it. So it will always be tension here and friction and conflict. We never will like this place. So how can making it more pleasant, that's really not the goal. Because it'll just mean, well, we'll delay a little longer in this place of misery. Why do that? Why spend one's efforts trying to delay a little longer? Because a little longer, that gets leveraged into a little longer, and then that gets leveraged into a little longer. It goes on and on and on like that. And whatever superficial pleasantness we can find in this world is like nothing to us. It's like tinting your hair, and thinking that you're younger when you're really not. You know, putting a fresh coat of paint on a dilapidated home and thinking that you've renovated it. You have not. You cannot renovate existence. Existence is what it is. It's a picture of vulnerability, modification, impermanence, destruction. Temporary. Excuse me just a minute. Okay, so existence has to portray forgetfulness of what spirit is. Has to, that's its purpose. So you cannot change its purpose. So it'll always be the way that it's always been. Constant change, constant turmoil, constant modification, constant attempt to wall off remembrance of what we are. Constant attempt to make this world attractive and pleasant so we don't feel attracted back to what we are. Don't feel attracted to remembrance. Has to be that way. You cannot have an idea without its effects. The idea of trying to be prime creator has to have effects. Those effects have to be effects that induce forgetfulness of what we are in us. Has to. It's impossible to change the basic purpose of existence. So it will always be very unpleasant for us. Horribly unpleasant. And there are ways to try and dull that unpleasantness, that distaste, you know. But it's still there. It's like eating a super hot pepper. And it's just burning, terrible burning. And you'll be drinking milk, trying to kill the burn, you know. But the burn's still there. It goes in our stomach. It's still unpleasant. It's very unpleasant. We can try and, you know, do some things to at least take the most severe edge off of it. But the overall unpleasantness is still there, no matter what we do. It's futile. You cannot change the purpose of existence. You cannot have an idea and then have effects that don't align with that idea. It's not possible. I would literally be changing reality to do that. And the effects of existence do align with the idea of trying to be prime creator. They absolutely align with that. Of spirit trying to be prime creator, trying to experience that, trying to forget what it is. Because if spirit knows what it is, it knows that it's created by the prime creator, and therefore spirit knows it can't be prime creator. It's impossible. So spirit has to be in a state of forgetfulness to even entertain this idea at all. It has to feel that this is a new home, that this is home. This existence, spirit has to believe this is home. It has to believe that these bodies are its identity. That the body dwelling in this planet is that's what spirit is. Has to believes that. Has to believe it. Has to buy into that. It's like watching a movie. If you buy into it, then it seems real. If you don't buy into it, it seems ridiculous. Seems meaningless. You can practice that. I don't advise anyone to watch movies, but if you find yourself on there, you can simply try to step back and don't buy into any of the premises at all. And see that suddenly the whole thing becomes flat. And you just realize it's a bunch of flickering light on the screen is all it really is. There's no depth to it at all. It only acquires depth if you buy into the basic premises and suspend a willing suspension of disbelief. Same thing here. Spirit has to have a willing suspension of disbelief in this. Because really, this whole scenario is completely unbelievable. And yet, spirit can suspend that disbelief. Now we're looking here visually at this bridge. We had just had the 75th anniversary of the Golden Gate Bridge, maybe the most famous bridge in the world. And apropos of that, the truth is that there cannot be a bridge built between truth and lies. That truth is always true and lies are always lies. There is no such thing as a true lie. The bridge that is built is not really, it's the bridge of effort, okay? It's the bridge of going to the mountaintop for a little bit each day. That's the bridge. It's not leveling the mountain down, okay? That is not the way to do it. In other words, it's not to bring more levels of clarity and then providing, people say, oh, it's easier. Let's say you have a mountain station at 5,000 feet and you have one at 10,000 feet. And the people go to the one at 5,000, they say, it's not so tough to breathe here. But when I go up to 10,000, it's very tough. So they say, there's a teacher up to the 10,000 level, and they say, come on, teacher, come on down here to the 5,000 foot and teach here. Because the air is easier for us to breathe here. Okay. But that doesn't work. That provides a false path. What one has to do is go to the top of the mountain, go to the 10,000 foot mark, and get used to the air up there. And maybe one can't stay there as long. But that's okay. You go back again and again and again, and it gets easier and easier and easier to stay there. So, you don't... Let us say there's the top of a mountain, and on that top of the mountain, one has a panoramic view of the landscape everywhere. One is able to see the totality of the landscape. But only from that top of the mountain peak can one see that. And from that mountaintop, one can see the ocean or see the destination one wants to get to. Without getting to the mountaintop, can't see it. So the goal is to get to the mountaintop and take a look. And some people say, well, why don't we lower the mountaintop? Let's work real hard, undermine it, and lower it down, so it's a lot lower. That way we don't need to climb as high. But if you lower it down, you get to the top, you can't see. You can't see sufficiently. It's a waste of time. So teaching always has to be the highest teaching. And your effort has, the goal is not to lower the teaching, but to raise your level of effort. And one might say, they complain they don't have the motivation. Well, in order to succeed, the motivation has to be there. So one has to have determination to succeed, and then some motivational experience will take place. Some glimpse of truth will take place. And then you'll see, aha, it's worth the effort. But I have to climb to the top instead of try to lower the mountain down. What has happened in this world is we've lowered the bar of expectations to try to get everybody in. And we call that progress. We've advancing. No, we're just lowering the bar. We're saying everybody has turned into a really great hurdlers now, because everybody's jumping over the bar. So instead of just a few people jumping over the bar, now everybody can jump over it. So we've made vast progress around the planet. No, we haven't. We've simply lowered the bar down to the ground. So nobody just stepping over the bar, they're not jumping at all. It's an illusion of progress that we have here on this planet. Under the guise of being fair, the ego sponsors all that fairness, so-called fairness. Says, well, it's not fair. The ego says that some people have trouble climbing the mountaintop, so let's just lower the mountain down. It's not fair that people have a problem jumping over this hurdle, so let's just lower the hurdle down. Of course, the purpose of jumping over the hurdle is to get more spring in one's legs. If one can't jump over, they have to work out and get more spring. Purpose of going to the mountaintop is to be able to see the totality of the situation. You lower the mountaintop down, you can't see the totality of it. And then you're completely vulnerable to the ego's agenda and its guidance. That's what's taking place here in the world. It's that, and under the guise of fairness and tolerance and all-inclusiveness, standards have been dropped way, way down. The bar has been lowered way, way down. So everybody has this illusion of progress. They say, hey, I'm in too. You know, I get it. I went to a seminar, you know. They say, well, yeah, I attended a seminar. So I did my part. I did it. And then they don't do any more. That's it. You know, I got my diploma. You know, it's like giving everyone a diploma even though they haven't done anything. Everyone's a winner. That's a terrible, terrible egoic mirage. If there's no standards, no expectations, there can't be any real success. It's meaningless. So we have a world full of people who are drunk on the idea that they've succeeded, that they've been successful, and this world has advanced. Whereas what's happened is we've made a vast effort to tear down expectations, lower expectations, so we can be all-inclusive, so nobody's quote-unquote left out. But left out of what? We have a big group is gathered, and there's no teaching. So what is the success there? It's the ego's success, really. The ego will say, yeah, we've been successful in getting rid of those high expectations. Now, the ego tells, don't you feel better now? Don't you feel less strain, less demand on you? Now you can spend more time in bread and circuses paying attention to entertainment. Now you can be lazy. You don't have to work hard anymore. Now everything will just be given to you. You know, now you've succeeded at that. Isn't that great? And of course, that's the road to perdition for sure. It's the road to continued forgetfulness of what you are, which is spirit. It's the road to dismal continuation of forgetfulness, which is really a horrible, horrible thing. Will put on any type of song and dance for us here in the world. It's working on it, really working on it, and it keeps saying, don't remember what you are, because the song and dance here in this world will be made very, very attractive for you. Whatever you want, I'll put that dance on. And the ego tells us, we haven't seen anything yet. You know, you've seen nothing yet. Because the ego will trot out all the sins of the flesh, you know. All the safeguards against that have been removed. So we really are returning to like Roman times. Times of great wickedness. Unbridled sensuality and entertainments. Of the most vicious kind, you know, the kind that's just shocking, brazenness. We're entering a time of extreme arrogance and brazenness. We tend to forget what was taking place in Rome back in a couple thousand years ago. The entertainments there were barbaric beyond description, and the people loved it. I mean, that was a normal thing for them. Let's go to the Colosseum. That was high society went there. The wealthy matrons loved to go there. Population, those could afford it. The more money you had, the more you could afford the more barbaric and heinous type of exhibits and displays and exhibitions of cruelty you could afford to see. That's literally what was taking place. And you can see how the planet here is veering back into that, into being attracted to mayhem. It's creeping in bit by bit by bit in many, many, many ways. Used to be, for instance, like professional wrestling, you know, that came on the scene. And all this, you know, drastic, extremely hurtful stuff was being on the television, but it was being faked. They were athletes who were very adept at faking, like they were being, you know, just pile driven and all this stuff. Very clever fakes. Now, but then that developed to some of the stuff these days where people are just trying to tear each other's heads off, and it's not fake. So you see that there's a progression, there's a desensitization. First comes the fakery, but then later comes the real stuff. You have the mixed martial arts, MMA, and all these kind of you know, fighting that's gotten into the culture very strongly, very strongly. But prior to that, it was being faked, but now it's not being faked. Very violent stuff now. So first you have the fakery, then you have the real stuff that takes place here. So that's why I say that video games are so dangerous, because that's fake. I mean, it's not really happening. But fakery is a precursor to the actually taking place, where people get desensitized. Say, hey, you know, it's no big deal. Easy step. You can see the progression that takes place. That's how the ego, quote unquote, guides the world back into barbaric bread and circuses, where people are taking more and more risk, more and more danger, more and more thrills, more and more closer and closer to blood sport. Really, if you see all the entertainment, etc., the ego is hell bent on bringing back those times. Because the Romans were in severe forgetfulness of what they were. That was keeping them from forgetfulness. And, of course, they slaughtered the Christians at that time. They would hunt them down like animals, execute them, crucify them. Incredibly vicious, barbaric situation, and yet that was the height of sophistication of the time. That was the ruler of the world at that time, the most powerful empire, who thought of themselves as very advanced and very sophisticated, and yet they got pulled down into this extreme wickedness And somehow we seem to think that we are immune from that. Not at all. Because what guided the Roman Empire into that? The ego did. The ego agenda did. Forgetfulness, the necessity to forget what we are, to provide any entertainment that will get our mind off of satsang. The remedy isn't to get rid of satsang. The ego tells us that, but that's a lie too. Because the attraction to remember what we are is there whether there's satsang or not. And so the ego is forced to provide distractions from that and try to wall that attraction off and try to provide entertainments and distractions whether there's satsang or not. So really the ego is trying to keep us away from remembrance of what we are, which is a futile quest. It can never succeed. It only temporarily can it manage to lessen the attraction seemingly or distract us sufficiently so we don't attend satsang. But it cannot solve the problem at all. So since it can't solve the problem at all, we have no option but to attend satsang. We have no other option. You cannot legislate it away and think that's going to solve the problem. It doesn't. It does not. So the ego is desperate to keep turning people away from remembrance of what they are. And to that end, the ego has to continuously up the ante on the entertainments here in the world. It has to keep hitting lower and lower below the belt. It has to really punch you in the gut. Gut-wrenching stuff, horrifying stuff. You know, it's unbelievable the progression that just has been seen in this world. Going into more and more ghastly, horrifying stuff, which presents extreme vulnerability, extreme deadliness, extreme treachery, extreme attack, extreme fragmentation. All these extremes get more and more extreme because that helps forgetfulness of what we are. Because what we are cannot be attacked, cannot be harmed in any way, cannot be terrified, cannot be fragmented, cannot die. It's perfectly stable, perfectly eternal, perfectly invulnerable, perfectly free. So the ego, in order to get us to keep forgetting what we are, has to provide the opposite of that and make it more and more and more ghastly and terrible, because whatever the ego does, we get tired of it. And the attraction to remember is still there, and we still want to remember what we are. So the ego has to keep upping the ante. As soon as we fall away from satsang, the ego will then immediately grab hold of us and start steering us in the wrong direction, and will bring us into great wickedness and keep doubling down on it. So when a world loses its nerve for clarification, it inevitably turns toward wickedness and degenerates. And we're in an incredibly degenerate era right now on this planet. We are free-falling towards a full-blown scenario of mayhem. And the will of the planet is not there like it used to be to stop this. The will isn't there. There's been generations now raised that have no will in that direction. Very little. There are exceptions within each generation, of course. These are generalities. We can't speak of every single person in every generation. But the overall will has been severely diminished. As people, young people, are raised on increasing levels of decadence and violence, fragmentation, attack, ghastly, horrible stuff. All the offerings of the ego, they're raised on that. They're directed toward that instead of satsang. It used to be there are generations past and places in the world where the children were raised very strictly in a climate, atmosphere of satsang, of devotion, of using all their free time and energy to clarify. And the talk was of talk about clarification. Questions were talk about clarification. Whatever entertainment was utilized was always for the purpose of clarification also. The songs, the dances, whatever was done was in the context of clarifying truth. And the children grew up in those circumstances. Contrasted that with what the children are going up with right now, the circumstances. It's night and day. And whatever time is taken away from clarification, the ego grabs it up and will turn it in its direction of forgetfulness. And the ego always has to double down, because whatever it does, it doesn't work. So it has to keep offering new stuff that's more shocking. Has to. The only remedy is to turn back to satsang. Because the ego, what happens is, whatever the ego offers, we get tired of it, we get bored of it, and we still have this feeling of wanting to remember something. And the ego calls the sinfulness, we still have this feeling. So the ego then has to increase the shock value, the distraction value of what it's offering us, in order to keep us going on that, on its path. And we get bored of that, the ego then has to increase it more. And that goes on and on and on, and there's no end to it, really. The ego will literally lead the world down so that people are literally at each other, you know, tooth and nail. Complete mayhem. It'll literally, if we don't turn back towards clarification, towards satsang, we'll simply, they'll keep doubling down and lead us absolutely into complete mayhem. Some people are starting to flip out that way already in the world. You see that every day there's another, you know, mass shooting, mass bombing, you know, mayhem. It's not like, you know, it literally, if you look at it, it's going towards mayhem, which is just people flipping out. And the flipping out can be more than just one person. It can be groups of people too. It can be entire countries. It can just flip out. When that happens, you get wars. We've seen that last century. You know, some countries just flipped out, absolutely flipped out, and just went berserk. Whole entire country just decided, hey, we need to take over the world. Let's just attack all these countries and enslave everybody and steal everything we can steal and plunder and pillage and rape and kill people. And let's just go on a swath of devastation and let's just do it. It's completely flipped out. Entire countries. Sorry, it just happened, you know. Last century. Number of times. Whole groups of people can just flip out. Because why? Because they're listening to the ego. Country that is paying attention to satsang does not flip out. The will to flip out is not there, or the lack of will to maintain focus is not there. Or put it in a positive way, that the will to maintain focus is there. The will to maintain focus on clarity is there. That means the people of a country who are paying attention to clarification, they're not going to go crazy, they're not going to flip out, they're not going to go to berserk, they're not going to engage in mayhem. I mean, we have had countries engaging in mass mayhem recently, and the situation right now in the world is much worse than before. You could have an entire planet engaging in mayhem at this point, not just one country. Because the ego has been relentlessly beating down the notion of spending time in clarification. It's been demonized. The truth is that those who value clarification, who believe there's such a thing as salvation or liberation from suffering, that there's truly, that we are truly in a state of forgetfulness of what we are, and that Prime Creator is a loving Prime Creator and wishes us nothing but the very best to be saved from our misery. When that's the focus, then that nation is not going to just flip out and engage in mayhem. and that's a focus for a group, then they will value maintaining their time on clarification. They will use their time to clarify. They won't use their time to go crazy, spend time in craziness. Guaranteed. So the world is a very treacherous place. If we get lazy here, the ego grabs a hold of us. And the ego will pull us down into its den, into its lair. And as we get bored with that, it'll pull us deeper. As we get bored with that, it pulls us deeper still. And you can see the trailers for the movies these days, you know. It shows the ego is been very, very busy pulling us into ever, ever darker places, places of ever greater mayhem. As you look at the trailers for the movies these days, what are you seeing? You're seeing more and more sophisticated mayhem, trying to make mayhem attractive. Make it cool, you know, make it culturally cool. It's a cool thing. Literally, that's what the ego is selling. It's trying to make mayhem cool. Okay, this is hip. This is the new thing. Mayhem is the cutting edge. And you get all these movies and teachings and etc. Attitudes that are being pressed on people to engage in blood sport in one way or another. And that's supposed to be cool. Killing, they say, well, killing is cool. You know, vampirism is cool. Attacking people, bloodlust is cool. All this wicked decadence is, you know, they try to portray it as it's cool. They're trying to portray that. That this is advancement. And that those who are not doing this don't get it. Well, they don't get the ego's purpose because they know the ego's purpose is futile. It's a waste of time. They get it. They get it's a waste of time. They get that very clearly. And if you get that, what else is there to get? There's not something else to get. If something is truly a waste of time, if something's impossible, that's all you need to get about it. Nothing more. There's nothing more to get. But the ego claims that those who are spending their time on clarification, on satsang, they don't get it. They don't get it. Now they do get it. They do get it that what they're doing is right use of time. And the ego's purpose, agenda, is wrong use of time. That's all you need to get. The ego's agenda is, goal is impossible to reach. The Holy Spirit's agenda is possible to reach. It's inevitable to reach. Once that is seen, then they get it. So, and that is cool. Getting it is cool. So all that the ego can assert is that not getting it is cool. That remaining in misery is cool. That this, somehow this is all, you know, this is great. But, you know, you have to be a knucklehead to buy into that agenda. And there are a lot of knuckleheads in the world. And the ego has a hard time keeping them dumbed down, has to keep doubling down. So if you wonder how things progress in this world, they progress because the ego has to double down. It has no other option because we see through, we get tired, we get bored, we realize that the attraction to reality is still with us, no matter whatever the ego's done already, the attraction is still there. So we have a choice. We always have this choice. We get up in the morning and say, well, should I pay attention to truth or should I double down? Because I can't stay where I'm at because I'm already bored with it and I know it doesn't work. So literally, if one does not pay attention to clarification, spend their time that way, there's no other option but to double down. Can't keep the status quo. Status quo is not keepable here. Because the ego can't keep offering you the same old stuff, because then if ego did, you would turn away from the ego and turn to satsang, and you'd pay attention to that. And say, whatever the ego has to offer me, it's not sufficient, it's not working. I'm going to pay attention to truth because I know that works. That automatically take place. So the ego has to double down. Has to keep presenting something stronger, stronger and stronger medicine. That's why you see the trailers for these movies are becoming more and more hyper-violent. Sex and violence is what the ego uses to shock and titillate and distract. And it has to keep upping the ante, more and more shocking, more and more horrifying, until, you know, you end up with human sacrifice, you end up with mayhem, and with people tearing other people apart. You end up with mass rioting and chaos. And people look at that saying, yeah, this is very distracting, this is helpful. Those who are with the ego's agenda are looking for success. And for them, success, it means ultimate distraction. So there's no more attraction to what they really are. And they're pursuing that ultimate distraction. And to reach in the pursuit of this, they keep doubling down and doubling down and doubling down. There are some entities in the cosmos who have doubled down to a great extent. And they are actually have infiltrated this planet. And so their attitudes towards distraction are formed from doubling down very severely for a long time. So they require an enormous wickedness and distraction in order to maintain the feeling of success. And so that is why the world has been tipped in that direction so severely, is there are those on this planet in control of some very significant areas of the planet that they are presenting this entertainment that is so extremely wicked and so shockingly distracting, because that's what they require for just to keep themselves distracted, because the rest of the stuff they've already tried and it doesn't work. And so literally they are setting up this planet for a mass sacrifice, because for them that's all that works to distract them. They can only be distracted by planetary mayhem, planetary catastrophe on a vast scale, massive amounts of terrible tragedy and horrific stuff happening. And there's some people that just can't wait for this to begin, but so they can just engage in mayhem. They're all ready for it. Because only that provides enough distraction for them to feel like they're still succeeding. They call it self-esteem or some nonsense like that. But it really is a sense of succeeding in forgetting what they are and being able to getting close to completely separating from any attraction towards remembering what they are really are, which is spirit. And of course it's impossible to accomplish this, and yet they feel if they don't keep succeeding at this that somehow they're going to be destroyed, which is nonsense. They will simply find themselves paying a little bit of attention to clarity. That's all that happens. When one finally gives up a little bit of effort to distract oneself, all that happens is a gentle reminder. One might see, just notice something they never noticed before. They say, wait a minute, how could I overlook that? How could I possibly have overlooked that all these years? It was right in front of my face the whole time. Some simple little thing. And it's very gentle, and then gradually you have many of these little mini recognitions, like, oh, I never saw that before. And you start asking, how could I possibly have missed that? Well, because we were hell-bent on distracting ourselves. Now, there is no annihilation if one gives up the path of distraction. It's just a perfectly smooth segue into gradual, gentle clarification, spending time with clarification. Maybe you won't spend a little bit of time, then a little more. That's all that happens. So don't buy into this nonsense of those who are desperate for blood sports on this planet, that if they don't get what they want, that somehow they're going to be annihilated. That's a lie of the ego that just justifies what they're doing. The ego tells us, you know, that some will be saved and all the rest will be destroyed. That's a lie of the ego. What does that do? It simply terrifies everybody into trying to succeed with the ego's agenda. That's all that it does. Because they have an excuse. They say, hey, if I quit, I'm going to be annihilated. That's a lie. It's not true. No truth to that whatsoever. And they also say, well, if I quit, I'm going to be thrown into some discontinuity. Not true. All that happens is if one eases up on trying to distract oneself, one just simply starts noticing little things. Noticing like what's going on a little bit. Say, wait, hey, that I see that someone is trying to do this, and that's obviously I see that's distortion. Or you know, just start becoming clear, a little bit of clarity. The fog starts lifting a little bit. That's all that happens. So again, the ego has promoted this notion that those who fail will be annihilated. Of course, it's twisted this around and tried to say those who fail to reach, you know, salvation will be annihilated. That's a way of presenting it in a twisted way, so we don't really see what it's really saying. There's no truth to that whatsoever. Nobody, no aspect of spirit can ever be annihilated. What happens is simply they keep doubling down until they're just so sick of it. They decide, you know, they just don't want to do it anymore, and then they start, a little bit of clarity starts creeping in. That's all that happens. But what we have here on this planet now is a very large influx into this planet of those who have doubled down to a very large extent for a long period of time, and they require enormous distraction. So they have rigged the planet so that it will provide them with this level of distraction. So horrible stuff is likely to happen here, really. It's already happening. I mean, look at the last 12 years or whatever, you know. Look at the world since 9/11. Every day some suicide bomber is just blowing up civilians to smithereens. It's horrible stuff going on constantly around the planet now. Every day some crazed gunman just opens fire, you know. It's crazy stuff. And these people who require high-level distraction, they're not getting enough from the world. They immerse themselves in video games that, you know, have just enormous shock value, gore. I mean, I've heard parents saying they're absolutely shocked when they see what their children are playing these games. That the parents say, you know, they would, you know, never. And these are parents who think they're really hip. And they tolerate a certain level of violence and shock. And they see the stuff their kids are looking at, and they are literally stunned and shocked. They're saying, what the heck is going on here? Because these people are coming into the world now, they require an enormous level of violence and mayhem to distract themselves, because they've doubled down, they've followed the ego's agenda for so long, that anything less than that doesn't really distract them. And so they require these video games and if they don't get them, they get extremely agitated. It's an addiction. It's a compulsion, something of a deep necessity that's driving them. They feel if they don't get it, they'll be annihilated. That's the ego's lie. Big, big lie of the ego. And that's actually in some of the religious teachings of the world, the ego's co-opted them and said that people will burn in eternal hell. You know, well, they will certainly burn, but that too, that burning too, is a level of distraction. That's what they're aiming for. People here on the planet will certainly get fried, but that experience is something that many, many, many need to remain distracted. That's just doubling down. That's just another doubling down. And then from that point, they'll require something even stronger. Stronger medicine. And at some point, they'll just say, hey, I just don't want to keep doing this. I'm sick of it. And then the clarity starts creeping in. And before you know it, but even within one lifetime, one can get free of it all. I could make a complete turnaround and see through it all and see the totality of the situation and reject all of it and say, no, this is all I see, the folly of what I've been involved in. So no one has ever lost. One just continues to double down until they get tired of it. I say, on the other hand, there are many here in this world who don't not only do they not require severe distraction, they don't even want any distraction. They want to lessen their distraction, double down in the opposite direction, get less and less and less distraction. And so this planet may not be a good place for those who are oriented in that direction. I don't know if there will be sanctuaries on this planet or not. Possible, but I have a feeling that as things progress, as the doubling down of the ego, the ego has this vast blueprint for doubling down. It keeps upping the ante. More and more drastic stuff keeps happening to distract, for distraction. And I believe it has a blueprint that goes very, very far at this time, all the way towards, you know, planetary catastrophes, etc., that just bring about, you know, massive destruction. Because there's an appetite for destruction. There's so many here that have this massive appetite for destruction. And even in the music they listen to, it's blatant. You know, they're saying, they're screaming with this very, very violent, destructive kind of music, and screaming about their appetite for destruction. But they're just, so it's blatant. They're desperate. They need it. It's like they need their fix. They're like drug addicts. They need their fix of destructivity to keep them distracted from, keep them from being attracted to remembering what they are. Because they're still believing the ego's lie that if they fail to completely forget what they are, that they're going to be annihilated, which is 100% lie. And eventually everyone will turn away from the ego. That's why there's compassion for everyone. Doesn't matter, the level of wickedness can be very extreme, but they have no choice but to turn away from it. I mean, that is a literal fact. No aspect of spirit can ever be destroyed. Spirit is invulnerable. Even God cannot destroy spirit, because spirit is one with God. Reality, the totality, is one. Like I said before, you cannot destroy any aspect of reality, because it's all one. You either get rid of all of it or none of it. No aspect of spirit can ever be destroyed, because it would mean the destruction of the totality of reality. And reality is endless. How can you destroy endlessness? Reality cannot be touched, cannot be harmed in any way. And therefore no aspect of spirit can be harmed in any way. Not really. Spirit can distract itself from what it is. But that distraction is very difficult, and gets more and more difficult as one develops a tolerance for it and gets bored of it and realizes, hey, that what I just did doesn't work anymore. I need something more vicious, more extreme. You know, we're in the time of extremeness, right? Fanaticism, extremity, extreme sports, more and more risky stuff. Jumping out of airplanes, diving off of bridges, that, you know, that's been tried, and now there's more and more extreme sports, more and more dangerous stuff that's been tried. And you know, you're going to see a jumping into more, even more extreme stuff that crosses the line over into wickedness. You see that with the violent sports, on, you know, the MMA type of sports, the extreme violent stuff where people are almost trying to kill each other on camera. Getting close to that. We're getting close to the gladiatorial days. Very close. Only this time it will be on a much vaster scale. And you know, people will be hunted. You know, it's almost like a survival type of thing, where actually, you're seeing it in Mexico. What if you want to know the future of this planet, look at Mexico. And actually, the immigrants from Mexico, those who have come up here, whether they've come here legally or not, the fact is that they've served a very useful purpose, helpful purpose, because they've warned us, they've drawn our attention to what's going on there. I mean, I've gotten first-hand information of what's going on there. And they say, hey, you know, we're fleeing this stuff. We're running for our lives, which is true. To a large extent, it's the collapse of civilization in Mexico is horrific, and the stuff that's happening there is simply barbaric beyond any capacity for most of us to relate to at all. And yet we just think it's some kind of dream, or they're making it up. You know, the dumping bodies on the freeway highway, completely chopped up into pieces, massive. You know, I don't know how many people, 49 people. Everywhere they go, every day they say, "Well, we just discovered another cache of bodies somewhere." The amount of mayhem in Mexico is off the charts. And some of it's coming from Latin America too. Some of the Mexicans are fleeing. The immigrants from Latin America are coming up, and they're you know, scaring them. So you have just a meltdown in Mexico and Central America has been going on for quite some time. And the level of savagery is off the charts and gets worse all the time. They have after school, you know, video centers where children go and play video games. And I asked what kind of games they play. They said, well, they love the most violent ones. The more violent, the better. They're brought up on this. So to them, it's like playing a video game. They don't really see much difference. The younger they are, the less judgment they have. And of course, they're on drugs, methamphetamine. And for them, it's easy to commit these atrocities. And the fact of the matter is that methamphetamine is being spread all over the world right now, hugely. That should be the red flag of all red flags right there. Combination of video games and methamphetamine, and the young people turn people into mass killers with wraiths, you know. They seem to have no humanity in them whatsoever. And in fact, they enjoy it. They're not repenting, they're glorifying it. They think this is great. Why? Again, because it provides a level of distraction that they require. And we wonder, how is it possible that people could behave in such a barbaric manner? It's because of this influence into this world of entities who've reincarnated on this planet, who require that level of distraction. And so they pursue it. They join the gangs. They know what they're doing. They're aiming for it. A person who requires less level of distraction will not aim there. You know, they'll aim somewhere else. For me, maybe I, you know, pay attention to a baseball game. That's about it. Or maybe listen to some music. You know, some beautiful, peaceful music. Or watch some golf. You know, that's the level of distraction that I use. But I'm even, you know, use less than that. Going less and less and less and less and less. So my level of distraction would be like, you know, this incredibly beautiful golf course. I'm playing golf there. And after that, maybe listen to some very calm and beautiful, soulful music. And then spend hours and hours in satsang. And, you know, that would be a day of distraction. It'd be better to spend all day in satsang. But, you know, of course, I realized that the gorgeous, you know, serene, beautiful golf course and the very peacefulness and the genteelness of all that is still level of distraction. It's still saying, look how attractive the cave is. Look. But there's an awareness of that. And it is a way of moving towards less distraction. As long as it's not an end in itself, and as long as satsang is predominant, then we have to acclimatize ourselves. And those who have been in severe distraction, which is almost everyone, has cycled through that, then they have to diminish the distraction. Step by step by step, you become less and less distracted, less potent means of distraction. And you go in that direction. And in golf, it's a, you know, it's a honor and trust and honesty are valued. You call penalties on yourself. You don't cheat in any way. You know, you're on a faith system, an honor system. And you can congratulate everyone when they make a good shot. If a great shot, you root for each other. When I'm on a golf course, I'm rooting for the other guy as much as I am for myself. That's the truth. I want him to hit a great shot. Why? Because it's inspiring. I like it. I say, way to go. That's tremendous. And people literally do. They congratulate each other on whatever good shots they make. They help each other out in every way. They help look for a lost ball. The ball's off course. I'll go look for someone else's ball as much as for mine. You know, it's a supportive situation where people are not trying to beat each other down, but trying to raise each other up. If I hit a good shot, I'm happy. If someone else hits one, I'm also happy. So there's a lot of value in that type of situation, actually, to trend you away from the vicious conflict that the ego presents. Now, I'm not saying, again, that it's not distraction. It is. But it's a much milder form, and it can be used to go toward an even milder form, you see. It's important to truly see other success as just as important as your own. And that leads one to, again, realize that no aspect of spirit is ever lost. And you can feel that. You can feel that, yeah, that this person is just as valuable to the Prime Creator as I am. You can use it as an expedient in many positive ways. And the beauty of nature can be used. A very still feeling of stillness and non-modification and beauty can be used to remind us that it's worth remembering what we are, because in those circumstances it's infinitely more beautiful. A resort is like a place where you go and you get this jolt of a very high level of beauty. But one should not come away with them with the feeling that one should go out and try to beautify the entire world, produce an overlay of all cosmos, because that's the ego agenda. But by going to a very beautiful, serene place, the Holy Spirit can use that too and say, hey, you know, calm down, get away from the frantic distraction of the world. Spend more time in satsang. It can help. Retreats can help. But we're not supposed to try to turn the entire world into a retreat, because that then is the false overlay. That's the ego agenda. Make this world so attractive we don't even want to remember what we are. That's not the point. We go to a resort, a beautiful place, and then we come back and we say, okay, I'm inspired. I want to remember what I am, what I really am, because I know it will be way, way better than this. I need to choose the overlay, because the overlay literally does more than beautify the whole cosmos. It blesses the whole cosmos with an unwavering blessing. Everything is blessed. Those are the saints. The ones who live in that, they're experiencing this blessing of the whole cosmos continuously. One goes to the retreats and they're very quiet, and they're not engaged in frantic making blueprints to change the world. They're simply abiding in this serene feeling. They're simply trying to immerse themselves in the peace and the quiet as a means of trying to move towards remembrance. Now, that's helpful. Can be very helpful. But it's not an end in itself. So, retreats should also have satsang. Something that golf retreats really don't do. They should. After a round of golf, one should should then spend several hours in satsang. Absolutely. One shouldn't just go to the bar and start drinking, you know, and gambling. That's what I see is after golf, they start, you know, gambling games and raucous laughter and drinking and et cetera. That's a misuse of the situation. That's a competitive type of thing. So there are ways to use expedience in this world to double down in the opposite direction, to get more and more serene situations that serve as pointers towards satsang, that are a type of satsang. But the best satsang is, I believe, clarification. More direct looking. It's not simply relaxation. You know, we spirituality has turned into a cult of relaxation. That's not it. It's taken one means as an end. And that's the ego tricking again. When I had opportunity to go to a beautiful place, I took video and pictures, and I worked hard there. And then I then used those in satsang. I had that in the back of my mind. I said, hey, you know, I can't stay here for long. I got to bring something. I'll bring back, and I'll see if I can use it, this beauty, to be and to inspire others to turn away from the vicious distractions of the ego and start doubling down in the opposite direction. So that's a right use of the situation. Plus, I was inspired to go, you know, remember my true home. And when one sees something that is very peaceful here in this world, one doesn't want to turn towards violence and unrest. It's distasteful. You know there's something better. But the unrest of this planet, you know, is very attractive. I have to emphasize this over and over again. Let me say this. When one dies, that's not the end. Because the death itself is the ego, part of the egoic agenda. And one doesn't become perfectly forgetful of reality once one dies. The desire to remember what one is continues. Because one is spirit. Spirit can't die. So what is dying? Just a tool the ego is using for forgetfulness, that dies. But spirit still has the problem of needing to repent and stop trying to be prime creator. That doesn't go away. So what happens is the ego will have push for another identification, another incarnation, another body. And the ego will then use that body to double down and use it for the purposes of forgetfulness. That's what happens. So one goes, cycles through again and again and again and again. The ego keeps raising bodies up and telling and playing with them, pushing them towards its agenda, distraction, and in order to keep spirit's attention on all this and keep spirit distracted. And there are those who have had many, many incarnations, and they've used it for the purpose of distraction. And they require now a very high level of distraction, very vicious type of distractions. Now, it's like their aspect of spirit, who's trying to forget what they are, trying to be prime creator, has gone through so much and is so bored with lesser distractions now that they require very, very vicious level of distraction to keep their interest in trying to be prime creator and keep their interest in forgetting what they are and to prevent them from turning towards remembering what they are, which they believe will be annihilation. So they're desperate for even more gore, you know, they're desperate for it. And so they incarnate, in other words, they identify with the body on this planet and they put their personality, their tendencies, attach themselves to these bodies here. So So the personality of that body then is the persona, the personality of this entity, which has had many, many, many incarnations and requires a high level of distraction. And so they will seek that out in this world. They'll do everything will be aligned in their life. All their efforts will be to provide this high level of distraction. Now, when you get just one, a few, you know, it's not a problem, but when you have a massive influx into this planet of personality complexes that survive death, personality complex does not go away with the death of the body. It remains. When that personality complex attaches itself to a body on this planet, when you have many, many, many personality complexes that require high levels of distraction, attaching themselves to bodies on this planet, identifying with bodies, and directing those bodies, guiding those bodies, they will guide those bodies towards providing the distraction that they crave, what they feel is necessary for them to avoid annihilation. You have then a situation of what's called decadence, extreme wickedness, that grows on a planet. It's like a virus, a cancer. And unfortunately, that has already happened on this planet. The signs of it are completely unmistakable, blatant, obvious. That there is this tremendous craving for higher and higher levels of distraction. And, you know, video games will suffice. They've already been there and done that, but that now has even become boring. They want the real thing, so to speak, instead of just playing a video game in their room and imagining how they want to actually see the planet plunged into just chaos, mayhem. And for them, that's what they crave. That's what they want. You get enough people on a planet, that's what they want. That's their purpose. And they have the sophisticated means. Remember, these people are sophisticated. They have incarnated many, 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 many times. And they've worked very, very strenuously to provide advanced, sophisticated means of distraction for themselves, which means they've been able to use high technology. They're very familiar with high technology. They've already done that. So that's easy for them to build a high technology structure here on this planet and provide these video games and all the wickedness that is made available through these technologies, all the pornography that is made available, all the extremely grotesque, decadent, wicked types of themes that are able to be presented through movies and made available digitally and shared over the internet. All these groups of people sharing stuff that is just so wicked, you know, so shockingly distracting. And they love it. I mean, they don't love it, but I mean, they're drawn to it like a moth to flame. They see this as a means to preserve themselves. Like vampires, they have to drink the blood, you know, of others to preserve themselves. They're like that. They're like psychic vampires. They require ever and ever escalating levels of violence and ghastly scenarios of distraction. And they're getting it right now, you know, through various means, but their aim is to actually get it literally with other physical bodies. That's their aim, and they're getting closer and closer to that. The whole climate of the world is descending into this type of mayhem. And we think people who don't require that we don't understand. We're certain that it's going to peak out and go in the other direction. But don't be so certain about that. I don't see any signs of it peaking. Because literally these people, these entities who have incarnated here in mass, require massive amounts of this distraction. They believe for their survival. It's for them, it's survival. They don't have wisdom perspective. They don't realize the ego's been lying to them about their annihilation, which can never take place. So they see it as a survival issue, which is why it's impossible to reason with them. I have found my efforts, I've made enormous efforts to reason with these people. I found it gets absolutely nowhere. Because to them, it's a survival issue. So the survival is non-negotiable, right? There is no negotiating the issue of survival. So the ego has posited this entire situation, set it in the context of survival, where they see that their survival is dependent on maintaining extreme distraction from turning towards remembrance of what they are, believing that what they are has been destroyed, and that they'll be turning towards nothing, annihilation, nothingness, nihilism, annihilation. They literally believe that. So for them, it's the survival of their soul is dependent, they feel, they believe, on ever-increasing levels of distraction and mayhem. That's why we can't deal with them. It's not, you can't deal with that mindset. There's no negotiation possible. There's no wisdom, can't get in there. That's why existence is so insane. That's why people were burned at the stake in the past. I mean, the church would use severe methods on these people, but there again, that gets very complicated, because there are people literally who require such high levels of distraction that they are seeking sacrifice, their own sacrifice, self-sacrifice. They're seeking self-immolation. They're seeking destruction of their body in wicked, severe ways. They demand it. They want to set themselves on fire. And again, those of us who require much less levels of distraction, or even turning away from any distraction, it's super hard to comprehend this. But I'm able to comprehend it at the level of clarity, clarification of the totality of the situation. Only there does it become obvious. Otherwise, I know so many very good, well-intentioned people here on the planet who are very naive. They simply don't require that much distraction. They require some, but not a super dose, you know, by any means. And they literally cannot see what's taking place. It just baffles them. And they just think that everything will be fine, because they don't see that this world has been invaded by beings, aspects of spirit, that are so addicted to extremely high doses of distraction, and that they literally believe that they'll be annihilated if they don't get their next dose, and the next dose has to be higher dosage, and that they have literally booby-trapped the planet, to set the planet up to give them the experience, the distraction that they require. People literally cannot fathom that, and so they just feel helpless, hopeless. They can't do anything about it. They feel like they just, that it's all going to just vanish, disappear, and tomorrow they'll wake up and everything will be fine. Not true. And these people are don't have any will to see through it all. They just don't see what's taking place at all. And so they think other people are crying fire, you know, false alarms. They think maybe I'm raising false alarms. It's not true. I'm raising a real justified alarm. And it's been extremely difficult for me to see through this. I can hardly believe it, really. I keep thinking that no, these people will come to their senses. I mean, they'll realize, hey, this is all folly. But they're not. Living here in Silicon Valley has been a great blessing, because I've been able to see this. I'm around these people all the time. I realize they're not going to stop. They literally are pursuing this all out, because they literally believe it's a survival issue. Whereas those who have got a glimpse of reality, they know it's not a survival issue. So there's this gap of recognition in this world, where those who have got a glimpse of reality, they know, this world is just a dream. You know, it's not a survival issue at all. And so they don't require high levels of distraction, because they know they're not going to be annihilated if they don't get it. They have that general feeling. So they're not pursuing it all out. But they don't realize that there are those who have not glimpsed reality, who have been in darkness for so long. And for them, it is a survival issue. They see it as a survival issue. It's totally in the context of a survival issue. And therefore, it's not possible to reach them through reason. through any means. Doesn't matter. You can scorn them. You can, you know, what are you going to do? Excommunicate them? They don't care. But can you shame them? Shame their conscience? No. I mean, the atrocities in Mexico, they're not abating. I mean, can you sit down with those people and reason with them? No. And getting back to the spread of methamphetamine around the planet, it's happening. It's already happening. It's very easy to produce this, and this provides the kind of fuel for these people to create mayhem. It breaks through barriers of restraint that the planet has had for so long to restrain this type of behavior. How has this barrier been brought down? Through drugs. Started out with simple drugs at first, but getting more and more dangerous drugs. And methamphetamine is an extraordinarily dangerous drug. And that's the drug of choice. These drugs are choice around the world, expanding more and more and more. And it's very difficult for those who don't see it as a survival issue. We can't really comprehend what's going on. It's difficult to comprehend. I'm able to comprehend it to some extent, but it's still very difficult, very difficult. But we really got to get real about it. You know, that's why I've been preaching sidestepping this whole situation, this whole scenario. It may be necessary to sidestep it all, because you cannot reason with these people. I think the problem is that most people of goodwill on this planet still think that reason will win out. It's possible to reason with these people. I don't see it that way. I don't think it is possible. These people see it as their survival, that they need to chop other people up just to survive. Why? Just to distract themselves. Because they see distraction is necessary, otherwise they'll be annihilated. So they're children of darkness. You know, we call them spirits of darkness. Spirits of darkness are simply those spirits who have not yet caught a glimpse of reality. They've not had a glimpse to remind them. Once you catch a glimpse, you're going to go towards that reality, guaranteed. But until you get that glimpse, you're going to be a spirit of darkness, and you will keep doubling down towards wickedness. You become very wicked. Very, very wicked indeed, where you can commit the atrocities that are taking place around the world. Okay, hold on here. I have to stop this. Another distraction. Hold on. Was rudely interrupted there, as interruptions do take place. We're talking about the spread of drugs, where it started out with milder drugs, like marijuana starts out that way. It does get into heavier and heavier stuff, because the distractions that are required are more and more extreme, and you get people, entities coming, incarnating into this world, who require such extreme distraction that they require very strong drugs to break through any barrier of conscience they might have. Because when one incarnates on this planet, they're going to get a feeling of conscience here. Because there are many people of goodwill on this planet who require less levels of distraction and really want to move towards remembrance of what they are. And they get some of that, the cultures there, in order to just dismiss all of these cultural barriers that we have here. They take methamphetamine and various drugs, extreme stimulants that just make them feel like they're supermen. And they're not bound by any barriers of conscience whatsoever, and they can engage in atrocities and not, you know, seem to bother them at all. The restraints are lifted by these drugs. So a drug culture was brought into this planet where we got more and more used to it, more and more accepting of drug usage. That again was the egoic agenda, setting this planet up to host these entities who require enormous extreme distraction. And so what I have been preaching, saying, is that it may be necessary to sidestep all of this. It may be necessary. Because certainly the high levels of abstraction don't serve us well at all. Not only are we disinterested in those, but we find it extremely distasteful. Just shockingly so. The ego will tell us we need to stay here, but merely as cannon fodder for the games of distraction that these entities are here to play. I see the ego sees those who have been loyal to it for a long time as very high level, as important. Literally, I'll tell you, you know, like in days past, the aristocracy, the higher ups who were very loyal to the ego, for instance, like in Roman times, the ego would put on these gladiatorial shows where people were devoured by lions and such as a reward. You know, this is a distraction for you. And these other people, you know, are just cannon fodder for you, for your amusement. So the ego sees those who have doubled down a long time and have stayed with the ego's agenda for a long time. The ego sees these as being very valuable, as very advanced entities. And it sees those who don't require such high levels of distraction, who are not so loyal to the ego. The ego sees these as simply cannon fodder, means to provide amusement, distraction for these other ones that value, the ego values more highly. So the ego does have a hierarchy of valuing. And for those of us in this world who are not loyal to the ego sees us as nothing more than cannon fodder. To simply be used for the amusement, sacrificial amusement of these other entities. That's how the ego sees us. So the ego literally tells us we have to remain on this planet. Why? Because we're useful to provide, the blood sport games for other entities. We're useful in that regard, as if we're to be hunted down, you know. So the ego tells us, no, you can't leave, because you're needed here. You got to stay here. It's required that you stay here, so that you can be an extra in the movie. Movies of mayhem, like you're an extra on the set. You know, you can't have a big catastrophe unless there's a lot of people dying, right? What kind of catastrophe would it be if there weren't any people there? You know, if a city, you know, collapses and is destroyed, if there's nobody in the city, you know, how big of a catastrophe would it be? So the ego, in order to put on these shows, make shows of distraction here, requires a lot of extras here. So the ego doesn't want us to sidestep the situation, go somewhere else, doesn't want us to. In fact, insists that we not do that. We all stay here and get fried. But I say, you absolutely can sidestep it all. You're under no necessity to obey the ego whatsoever, because the ego is nothing but a liar. When the ego says that these entities will be annihilated if we don't provide blood sports for them, if we don't offer ourselves up as sacrificial victims for them, that's a lie. They will not be annihilated at all. If they turn from the ego, the Holy Spirit will immediately start giving them clarity. Just like that. There's no gap, a zero gap. So it's a lie. We absolutely can sidestep it, and it's not a guilty thing to do. It just means that there'll be one less victim here for these entities to prey upon. That's all. And that won't hurt them at all, because they'll whine and cry and say, oh, we're going to be annihilated if we don't get our blood, you know, sufficient blood sports here. No, they will not be annihilated. That's their lie. That's the lie they're believing. And we don't have to believe it for them. We don't have to play along with that lie, because it won't come true. They will find out, much to their shock and surprise, that they suddenly begin noticing things, and they say, aha, wow, where did that clarity come from? And then they will go on the path of clarification. That's all that will happen to them, which is a great thing. So really sidestepping the situation is actually helpful for them, very helpful. The less distraction they get, the more inclined they are to turn towards clarification. They don't see it that way, but we see it that way, and that's the truth. And right now, I need to attend to some other things, some other minor distractions, I guess you could say. And hopefully we'll be back later on this Satsang-A-Thon on Memorial Day. All right, very great. Hopefully we'll see you soon. That's it.